Hey everybody, Glenn here from Good Movie Monday. I hope you're all well. Welcome to the first one of our videos in conjunction with the Melbourne Horror Film Society. I'm going to be presenting these to you all throughout the year, and we're going to kick it off with an interview with a guy that I'm sure you'll recognise from so many great films like The River's Edge, Teen Witch, Communion, Class of 1999, and do you remember... And you thought your parents were weird. That was always a favourite of mine. And of course, the seminal cult classic Near Dark, Joshua John Miller. Welcome to the Good Movie Monday verse, mate. How are you?
I'm good. Hello.
thank you for joining me. So this screening that we're talking about is all part of the Women in Horror Month. So I thought, what better way to promote that than by talking with somebody that's, you know, possibly the most memorable character from this film, Near Dark. Is it the film you get asked about the most?
Don't forget, Women in Horror. You guys should do something about the movie I wrote, The Final Girls.
I was going to bring that up at the end of the interview.
We should do a screening there, and then you'll have to fly me down to Australia, and I'll have to be there, and then, you know, it'll be perfect. Anyway.
Absolutely. I'll fork up for it, and yeah, sounds good.
I'm there.
Is it the film you get asked about the most, Near Dark?
It's the movie I'm most glad to be asked about.
Right.
Besides a couple other things. How's that? I mean, you know, it's like being in a cool new wave 80s band, you know, like being in that movie. I mean, look, Tangerine Dream did the music, the whole vibe of it, the look, Kathryn Bigelow. I mean, it just, you know, you feel like you were in a really cool new wave band, you know? So yes, I get asked that question a lot. By really interesting people, because usually people who love that movie have really cool taste.
Yeah, you're not wrong. Yeah. I wanted to sort of, you know, appeal to my own curiosity for a moment here, because when The Lost Boys came along, I think it's fair to say it was a sleeper hit, because it sort of didn't really get much traction until home video, at least down here in Australia.
Yeah.
But at the time, your brother was in The Lost Boys. Was there a sibling rivalry?
I mean, there's always sibling rivalry.
Between the films, because they were made, what, around about the same time?
There's, you know, I mean, sibling rivalry is, you know, just, it's just, you know, when you have an older brother, he's always, you know, got to be the alpha. You know, keep in mind, he's an amazing, amazing brother, an amazing father, one of the most brilliant people I know, honestly, one of the most brilliant, and impossible, but as most gifted people are, I mean, of course, I was like, we still fight about it, which one's better, or which one has more of a following. We still have these conversations, and he'll say something like, "Yeah, but yeah," and then I'll like send him articles that are saying Near Dark better than Lost Boys, and all these sort of like, you know, these things online that are just these endless, you know, thesis papers, and I try to give them shit.
Oh, that's hilarious. And for people watching that don't know, we're talking about Jason Patrick, of course. So I asked our friends at the Melbourne Horror Film Society if they'd like to contribute some questions to this. And okay. I have a few questions from Nicole McGrath, who's the woman curating this particular screening.
Very cool.
Yeah, and to connect it with the Women in Horror Month, which has actually been changed to the Women in Horror Movement, so it's an all-year-round kind of thing we're doing down here now. This was Kathryn Bigelow's first movie. Did having a female director on the film feel progressive at the time?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, she just created a, you know, she was, not. This sounds almost, I hope this doesn't come across as sort of misogynistic or sexist in any way, but she was maternal and yet also paternal. She was both. She has a very kind of, almost non-binary vibe about her, and yet she's tall and kind of stunning and austere, but she, the fact that she was a woman, which was unique at that time, and doing action and horror, was, it shouldn't be unique, because there's a history of women taking on genre prior to this, small, but there's women who've taken on genre. And but as a 13-year-old kid, I felt incredibly safe. She created an environment that you felt you were being protected. And I don't just think it was about the maternal female quality, or just her as a person. She had just, everyone had just come off of Alien, so they were already a tight-knit family. So then we would do dinners, and then I was sort of included as the new child. So they took me on as a family, and we became, look, making movies become your alternate family anyway for 6 months. And that's what's so tragic about when it ends, because then it's like you're an orphan again, looking for another family. And it's just always heartbreaking. And you just have like this huge event drop. But Catherine in that time, and still to this day, she's always like this powerful maternal figure in my life. And it's an experience that we all treasure. She would take us out. She would take me shopping for wardrobe and get to know me and work with me on the look of the character. And yeah.
Was she the first female director you had worked with?
I would say my mother was the first female director, and my grandmother. My grandmother was one of the first women in television directing, and she was also a theater director. And my mom would coach me a lot, so, you know, director. So I was a, I was always surrounded by strong women, so it didn't seem, it was comfortable for me to work with Catherine. I'm not going to say it was probably that easy for other men, or women for that matter. For me, it was normal.
Yeah, for sure. That's
and inspiring.
And that kind of speaks volumes to the performance itself, too, because it's very natural.
Well, yeah, I always like to overdo everything, and the best directors, that's my tendency to push, and the best directors are always like, less, Josh, less. Just do nothing here. Throw it away.
Yeah, right. In terms of the production itself, just a really weird question, but an interesting one. What are your memories of cigarette smoke on the set?
Well, cigar smoke, really.
Really?
So the guy, when I'm burning up at the end of the film, towards the end, on the highway, they had created a prosthetic cover on my face, on my cheek, which then was connected to pipes about, I don't know, 50 feet away, which had been created by the guy who worked, excuse me, I'm forgetting his name. We probably need to figure out his name. It's not Dick Smith, but it's someone that great. He had just come off of Aliens, but he'd created a contraption where he, this box was filled with cigars. And then he pumped the cigar smoke through my face from 50 feet away. So it had like this rich, thick quality of not this like wispy smoke, but only the kind of haze that you would get from a cigar.
Yeah.
12 of them.
My goodness, imagine, there's no way you could get away with that these days. It's just sort of
adds on to a child.
No.
Hey, I mean, I've never liked cigars really, so but it was, yeah, it was a lot.
That's awesome. An interesting point about the film too is that the word vampire is actually never mentioned in there. Do you know if that was an intentional thing, or whether Catherine and her co-writer Eric Red were just invested in the story and didn't think to mention it?
I can't answer for them. I'm going to theorize that the latter. I think it was to transcend the genre.
Yeah, fair enough. And you were so frequently cast as a young punk back in the 80s. You know, why do you think that was? Was that a reflection of just your personality at the time?
I think I just came across as a very troubled, dark figure, which isn't, which is kind of half true. I was definitely was happy in some ways, but there was definitely a lot of, you know, challenges going on growing up. So I think it came through my work.
Yeah. I mean, you're one of those faces that I certainly recall just through my youth growing up with, you know, movies through the 80s, you know, always knew that punk kid. You know, particularly that class of 1999.
And you know what? Oh God, that was I have stories about that movie. I think being a punk kid at the time felt like a scarlet letter in a way. Mm. I really wanted to be one of those happy kids on a TV show, and was in a family. Once again, it all goes back to like the orphan and needing to be part of a family. I really wanted to be on one of those sitcoms, but they would never cast me. And I could be funny, but they were like, he's too strange, he's too dark. So, but now as an adult, well, in quotes, adult. I look back at that time and I go, oh, that was way cooler being a punk kid than being some silly kind of, you know, polished kid on a TV show. You know?
Yeah. Well, you did make your way to the Wonder Years, if I recall correctly.
Yeah, but I was still like a punk rock. I was still a rocker on that show, and they hated me on that show. They hated me working on that show because I was just too. I was coming from indie movies, and television at the time was very regimented. You had to hit your mark. You had to do the same take every time. You had to be nice to Fred Savage, who was a little shithead. It was just sort of like this constant, you know. And I couldn't be confined. And they had originally wrote that role on the show for me to be a regular to come in, and but then I was just too difficult.
Yeah, right. Well, that's
too much of a punk.
Yeah.
not much has changed.
Well, you know, I wanted to sort of move forward a couple of decades to your writing, because as you mentioned at the start, if a lot of people aren't aware, you wrote The Final Girls.
Yes.
Firstly, will there be a Final Girls 2?
I mean, I think, I go back and forth. They just did played it at Quentin Tarantino's Theater in New Beverly a couple of weeks ago during the surge of the pandemic here, and people showed up, which was crazy. And more than half the people in the audience had never seen it. So that definitely has an afterlife. However, I would say that, does it need a sequel? I'm on the fence. Some days, yes. Some days, no. You know, my writing partner and I, he says yes, and then the next day he says no. I think it would just be fun to do it because we know exactly what the sequel is. It's just about convincing someone to pay for it. Yeah, but right. We probably have to just go write the script on spec and just give it a shot, you know?
For sure. I mean, I guess a sequel sort of would bode well in terms of The Final Girls being a movie that sort of, you know, pays tribute to franchises and things like that. So
yeah, I know. Look, it's all in there. It's all in the DNA, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Totally. Yeah. Well, I know we love the Final Girls on Good Movie Monday, so if did it, we would be buying tickets, that's for sure.
Okay.
But before I let you run, what can you tell us about the Georgetown project? Because I just looked this up and it's fascinating.
Well, you know, the lead is from where you are. Russell Crowe plays a distraught, newly sober. You know what? I don't know how much I can say, actually.
That's okay. That's okay.
Just say that Russell Crowe is in the movie. It's a psychological horror. And that's probably all I'm allowed to say.
That's fine. But you also have Sam Worthington's in there, yeah?
Yeah, Sam. He's from Down Under. Right. Sam is amazing. I love this guy. he's super sweet and just such a mensch. And works so hard, and he's really talented and really cute. So I really want to work with him again because I think he's just really special. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, I mean, they're amongst a much bigger cast. How did you manage to pull an ensemble that big together? Like, it's incredible when you read about it online.
Well, I mean, I think once you get Russell Crowe in a movie, everything kind of follows, right?
Yeah.
You know, so Russell, you know, he attracted a lot of talent. I'd like to believe that the story and the script helped, and, you know, myself and Mark, my partner on it, and Kevin Williamson and the whole, you know, so hopefully all those elements were the appealing parts. I mean, you know, movies come together, that movie came together really, really fast. And I think you just have to kind of, it's magic. And that sounds a bit Pollyanna coming from California here, but sometimes there's just something happens and all the pieces fall together, and then they fall apart and they fall together. It's just the nature of movies. It's very strange, dark magic.
Yeah, amazing. Well, I think we've probably teased enough there to perk people's curiosity if they haven't heard about it. Look, time is up. We've only scratched the surface with Near Dark, barely even.
Yes.
I could talk about
Near Dark forever. Yeah.
Yeah, it's such a great film. And for people watching, it is screening in Melbourne at the Melbourne Horror Film Society's Women in Horror Month screening on February 22nd. Visit their Facebook page for details. But Josh, thank you so much for chatting with me for this brief amount of time. It's been a real pleasure for me.
Same, neutral. Thank you for having me on. I appreciate it.
Caleb Colton no longer belongs to our world.
We'll give him a week to see if we can call him one of us.
He belongs to hers.
But you have to learn to kill.
He belongs to theirs.
I don't want to kill.
He makes a kill tonight.
And they all belong to the night.
It's 3 hours short for a bus to get home. You help me out?
What are you on?
Believe me, I told you.
Don't think of it as killing.
Evening.
Don't think at all. It's just something that you do night after night. It's only ever a question of how.
Nervous? I would be too if I were you. Near dark.
It'll be your boys falling in with control.
Check out time.
Sell some time, son.
God damn, this is my family. Let him go.
Near dark. Pray for daylight. The night has its price.